A warm welcome to SANDHAN. Today we are here to discuss a very interesting topic. I, Madhurita Chaudhary from MS University Baroda, and my friend Dr. Zakia Firdaus, again from MS University Baroda, are going to discuss a very important, a very significant topic of English literature, and that is Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest. Zakia, have you heard about a few epigrammatic quotations? For example, no man is rich enough to buy back his past, or men become old but they never become good. Mm-hmm. These topics, these quotations have a terrific sense of humor. Can you identify the writer?
Certainly, that's Oscar Wilde, the man in question whom we are going to interrogate for our students today.
Yes, our presentation is based on three categories. The first is author and his biography. Then we have the age, that is the Victorian age from which Oscar Wilde belonged to, and the play. And then we will also critique the play in detail. Oscar Wilde, can you please introduce Oscar Wilde?
Well, the complete name of this great legendary figure was Oscar Fingal O'Flaherty Wills Wilde. And his date of birth, 1854, 16th October 1854 to 30th November 1900. Going back to his parentage, he belonged to two very important personalities of Ireland. Especially, they're called as the Dublin intellectual. His mother was a forthright activist, wrote poems for young Irelanders. Her name was Jane Francisca Wilde, and she wrote under the pseudonym Speranza, meaning Italian word for hope. Sir William Wilde, his father, was a very influential ophthalmologist, a ear and eye surgeon, and was knighted in the year 1864 for his medical services, as well as being equally involved in the area of peasants' folklore and Irish archaeology. He was also a renowned philanthropist. Going back to the educational profile of this great literary figure, he was associated with the Dublin and Oxford universities, and especially he was trained in reading classics and reading greats, which are the Oxford prescribed courses on classical literature. His tutors were Walter Pater and John Ruskin, who in fact revolutionized his own way of looking at the society and also at literature. After university, he moved to London into fashionable cultural and social circles. And he was also prosecuted for libel, a charge for the act of presenting defamatory material to the public. However, we have seen that he has made few exoduses in his life from London to America, again back to London. And he was also involved in a great aesthetic movement for which he was hugely criticized in the press and in the media. Apart from that, his long association with Robert Ross was against the unrestrained prohibition of Victorian against homosexuality. However, his last days he spent in France and never returned to Ireland. He died as a destitute at the age of 46. But more importantly, he is considered as the leader of the aesthetic movement that advocated arts for art's sake.
Isn't this movement proposed and proponented by Walter Pater?
Certainly, certainly. And his training under him was the reason that he was able to locate literature not just as a reading narrative, but as a refined form of art.
A kind of refusal to accept reality, a kind of taking art for art's sake, so moving away from, escaping from reality.
That's right, that's right. To a certain extent, yes, but then he has written a lot which is a part of the reality for which he was equally questioned.
Right.
Anyway, now we come back to his literary achievements. We are here to discuss him as a dramatist, but more importantly, his interests were in journalism. He was the editor of the Ladies' World. His shorter fiction, as we can see on the slide, The Happy Prince, The Other Tales, Lord Arthur Savile's Crime and Other Stories, The House of Pomegranate, The Portrait of Mr. W.H., Essays and Dialogues, The Soul of Man Under Socialism, The Decay of Lying, and The Critic as an Artist. The fiction includes The Picture of Dorian Gray, published as the lead story in July 1890 edition of the Lipicon's monthly magazine. More importantly, now we move on to his long list of plays, and it begins with, as we can see on the slide again, Salomon, 1893, written in French, translated by Lord Alfred Douglas, Lady Windermere's Fan, A Woman of No Importance, An Ideal Husband, and The Importance of Being Earnest, which was first performed at St. James Theatre, London, on February 14, 1895.
The Importance of Being Earnest, if we may remark, it is one of the last plays of Oscar Wilde, yeah. And that is the discussion of our topic today.
Since the writer belongs to the Victorian period, I think it becomes imperative for us to know where and how we locate this Victorian period. Primarily, it is divided into two parts, the early and the later part. The first part, as you can see, is from 1837 to 1870, and 1817 downwards to 1901 is the period of the second movement of Victorian era, where the artist in question is located. But going back before to the play, it's imperative to know what this age was all about. As the name suggests, Queen Victoria was a reigning monarch. It was the most volatile period in the history of British literature and also in the history of British political arena. One of the reasons was the strong influence of the Industrial Revolution, which had grossly questioned the established belief systems and had in fact influenced writers in trying to locate themselves as independent identities, as well as the concerns of the nation. So there was a kind of a duality often being located as the, as in a very oft-quoted phrase, which is part of the Victorian temper, or the way we locate Victorian temper is this whole question of Victorian compromise. Now people like Tennyson, Browning, Meredith, Hardy, they all have been questioning this in their writing, where the self and the nation are at war or are at the crossroad. And we do find also a glimpse of this when we go back again to this writer in question. However, one thing is very significant here when we look at the age, especially when we look the way Thomas Carlyle, a noted critic, has talked about it. What he says that it was a time where there was a movement from the movement of levity and play to a more grave, serious world. In other words, it was a movement towards serious questioning, which was brought because of the result of the theories propounded by Charles Darwin, which had shooked the very establishment of what is called Christian theology, and more importantly, the position of man in society. These are the repercussions that we find also in the world of literature, including fiction and drama, and the play that we are discussing today somewhere tries to address that issue as well. Now, as I said earlier, that he belongs to the second phase of the Victorian age, and then it's important again to know how do we then locate this man as part of the later Victorian era. So what is important in the late Victorian era was that the whole question of earnestness was being debated. Now earnestness became the not the talk of the town, but the way you are conducting yourself.
So and that is very interesting to note. What is the meaning of earnestness? Since we are discussing the play, and the title of the play is The Importance of Being Earnest. So what is earnestness? In fact, earnestness comprises of two things. One is the quality of being sincere and the quality of being serious. And both have been critiqued by Oscar Wilde through this play, which is a very important thing to note.
And the best part is the second half of the title, which actually is a pun on what is being earnest. And if we go back to the full title, The Importance of Being Earnest, A Trivial Comedy for Serious People. The word trivial and the word serious they run together with a very serious mission by the writer, which we'll explore in the later part of our deliberation. Anyway, coming back, let us move on to the slide again. The full title, as you can see here, is Importance of Being Earnest, a Trivial Comedy for Serious People. The genre, yes, it has intermingling of genres. It's a social comedy, it's a comedy of manners, a satire, an intellectual farce that makes it even more interesting play, which has so many connotations in terms of form and also interpretation to the narrative.
So it has a society, it has the manners of the society, it has a satirical way of looking at society, and it also has intellectual perspective towards the society. All the things are comprised together.
And more importantly, the idea of play and fun, which is equally serious.
Right.
And that's the highlight of this playwriter, that how does he infuse this element of seriousness into the frame of farce.
Right.
That's right. Anyway, so we go back again to the slide. The time and place is summer 1894, Worthing, England. Date of first production, February 14, 1895. It was not published until 1899. The publishers were L. Smithers. And certainly, since it belongs to the genre of satire and farce, it is gone for conclusion that the tone had to be light, amusing, lively, and misleadingly frivolous.
That is something fascinating, because it is frivolous and yet it is misleading. So in a way, the play is being used to critique something. In a way, the play is being used to be sarcastic at something.
That's right. That's right. And that is why the word earnest is
so important,
connotated in such a way in the dynamics of the characters and also in the dynamics of the Victorian representation of human behavior.
Right.
Okay, now we move on to these important characters, and as you can look at the slide again, the first one who is the protagonist, Jack Earnest Worthing. The play's protagonist is seemingly a responsible and respectable young man who leads a double life. In Herefordshire, where he has a country estate, Jack is known as Jack. In London, he's known as Earnest. As a baby, Jack was discovered in a handbag in the cloakroom of Victorian Station by an old man who adopted him and subsequently made Jack guardian to his granddaughter, Cicely Cardew. Jack is in love with his friend Algernon's cousin, Gwendolen Fairfax. The initials after his name indicate that he is a justice of peace. The second character, Algernon Moncrief, again is the secondary hero. Algernon is a typically charming bachelor representing the gentry, the Victorian gentry, and he also is someone who is after the whole question of being earnest, though he is not claimed to be earnest, but he also creates another foil to the earnest in question, who is Jack the Earnest. And what is important that these two friends, how then they move on in the stream of the play, and where they make the whole question of earnest a debatable and a farcical one. Thereafter, we move on to Gwendolen Fairfax, who is Algernon's cousin and Lady Bracknell's daughter. Gwendolen is a typical representative of a young Victorian woman, known for fashion, known for mannerism, known for her some sense of obsession with the word earnest, so much so that she says that I would marry a person who has the name Earnest.
And critics call this earnest fixation,
That's right. Then we move on to Cicely. Can we have the slide again?
Yeah.
Cicely Cardew, she's Jack's ward, the granddaughter of the old gentleman who found and adopted Jack when Jack was a baby. And apart from most of these characters, she's the only one who is very realistically drawn, and that makes her someone more appealing to readers, that she's not located in the mannerism and the fashion world of Victorian hypocrisy. However, she's also somewhere caught in her own fixation of what is called as having an earnest man in her life. Now we come to Lady Bracknell, who is the epitome of Victorian hypocrisy. In fact, through him, the playwriter satirizes on the whims, the fancies, the materialist concern, and the way women look at men. And again, as we see that she is someone who is married to a good family, and that's what she wants, to a good family with a good name. She wants her daughter also to follow the same suit. In fact, she arranges a long list of prospective suitors and has all kinds of possible questions to see that her daughter gets the right choice, the right man of, I mean, a man who is supposedly earnest, but not really earnest in that sense. Anyway, she is a cunning, narrow-minded, authoritarian, and yet the most quotable character in the play. And then we have some other characters, Miss Prism, who is Cicely's governess. She is the endless source of pedantic bromides and cliches. She highly approves of Jack's presumed respectability and harshly criticizes his unfortunate brother. In fact, there is a strong sense of puritanism in her and the way she delivers herself when she tries to groom the women in that family. However, she somewhere also has secretly harbored a feeling for Dr. Chasuble, who is the rector at the estate of Jack, and he's someone who has been given the onus of christening the two fellows with the name Earnest, both Jack and Jack and Elginor. We have two more minor characters, Lion, who is a manservant who happens to just come for a short while in Act 1.
He in fact occurs only in the opening scene of the
That's
act.
That's right.
Of act
and
one.
Somewhere he knows about the burn-burning secret of Algernon, the only person who knows that. And then we have Merriman, who is the butler at the manor house, the estate in the Jack's estate in the country, and he appears only in Act 2 and Act 3. What is significant when we look at the plot of the play is the way Jack is living a dual identity. And he is in love with Fairfax. She only marry a man with the name Earnest. And at the end of the play, it turns out that Jack and Algy are in reality brothers. So a person who was seen at the Victorian railway station, left abandoned, finally gets a name, finally gets an identity, finally has secured a position. And in some ways, that's the reason he secures the hand of Fairfax. But more importantly, the other person who also somewhere is leading equally a dual life, who comes as Earnest when he comes back to the countryside, there is a topsy-turvy turn in the plot because somehow we come to know about their deceptions in the end. And that marks the farce, the comic in the play, yet a farce which needs to be questioned. Therefore, when we look at the outside, it looks as a very simple play with a very straightforward narrative, but it's now Madhurita who will give you a more serious critical view of what goes beneath the narrative and why the play has remained still a fascination today.
Well, the plot superficially seems to be very interesting, full of humor, but if we can look at the slide, it shows that the plot raises many questions, and three questions have been taken up by us. The first question is, how can Gwendolyn possibly be in love with the name Earnest? Why are they so much fixated with this name Earnest? The second question that comes to our mind is, isn't there something absurd about Jack calling himself Earnest when he actually is Earnest? His real name is Earnest. And the third question, which is an absurd question, of course, is how can a baby be misplaced in a handbag at a railway station? Imagine a baby being misplaced in a handbag at a railway station. Now, these questions bring to us some of the improbabilities of the play, and these improbabilities lead us to the subtitle of the play, that is, it is a trivial comedy for serious people. So the incidents are trivial, the subjects are serious, the subjects which are serious that are made trivial, and the trivial subjects are made serious. This again is closely linked with the philosophy of aestheticism, where there is a refusal to engage with reality, and this is the central principle of aestheticism. Now, unlike other 18th century satirists like Jonathan Swift and Alexander Pope, Oscar Wilde had no motive to be a reformist. In fact, he had no intention to reform this world, and therefore this style is his epigrammatic style is linked with the play's central metaphor, and the play's central metaphor is pretense, or we can call it Victorian hypocrisy. If we look at the other slide, which brings us to the central metaphor of the play, and that is Victorian hypocrisy. Now, there is this particular scene in which Jack proposes to Gwendolyn, and in this scene, we find a reversal of Victorian assumptions about gender roles. We find that propriety demanded that young women be weak, ineffectual, polite, behave like helpless vessels, full of admiration and passivity, whereas here we find Gwendolyn to be very authoritative, very domineering, whereas we find Jack stammering when he is proposing. So in fact, Gwendolyn takes over the entire business of marriage proposal out of Jack's hands, and she is the one who is leading. This, of course, leads us to the social commentary of this play, which is the Victorian concern with propriety. In fact, in the figure of Gwendolyn, we find a woman who is obsessed with the name Earnest, and she is actually not obsessed with the quality of Earnest, which we had discussed earlier. The discussion, of course, leads us to some of the most important themes of the play, and we take each of the themes one by one. The most important theme that we come across in this play is the theme of marriage. Marriage that is of paramount importance in the importance of being earnest. In fact, it plays a dual role. The first is it is a primary force that motivates the plot. And the second is that it is also a subject for philosophical speculation. It is also a subject for philosophical debate. In fact, the question of marriage, we find, it appears for the first time when there is a discussion between Algernon and Lane. And here Algernon says that a marriage proposal is a matter of pleasure. It is also a matter of business. So marriage is related with either business or with pleasure. Later on in the play, we find that Lady Bracknell also touches on the issue when she states that an engagement should come on a young girl as a pleasant surprise or an unpleasant surprise. In fact, we find that all the characters in this play have a set of assumptions about the nature and purpose of marriage, and these assumptions reflect the conventional preoccupations of Victorian respectability. We come to the second central theme of this play, and that is the constraints or the limitations of morality. Well, we find that there have been a lot of constraints about morality, and it is, of course, closely seen as a favorite topic of conversation in the entire play. For example, we find Algy. He has this presupposed notion about the service class or the servant class, which has the responsibility to set a moral standard for the upper class. And these restrictions, in fact, suggest these restrictions of morality, in fact, suggest that there is a strict code of morals that exists in Victorian society. And in fact, Oscar Wilde chose to write this play in order to break this strict code of morality. This, of course, leads us to the title of the play, and that is The Importance of Being Earnest, which discusses moral paradox. In fact, the play's central plot, which we see as as a play about a man who is both earnest and who is also not earnest. So both the things have been taken together and brought up as moral paradox. We come to the third theme of this play, and that is hypocrisy or inventiveness. Of course, Victorian hypocrisy, we have talked about it for a long time. Hypocrisy, we find that through the characters, hypocrisy is revealed. Through the characters, inventiveness has been revealed. For example, Algernon, not Jack, we find is the play's real hero. Not only is Algernon, like Wilde, is his dandified personality, he is also known for his exquisite wit, tastes and priorities. But he also resembles Oscar Wilde himself. In fact, Oscar Wilde in one of his interviews said that Algernon is my, or was my, alter ego. The fourth theme that we discuss in this play is the title itself, and that is the importance of not being earnest. In fact, earnestness, which implies seriousness or sincerity, is the greatest enemy of morality in the importance of being earnest, as we notice. We find that earnestness, or the quality of earnestness, brings about many other qualities. For example, smugness, politeness, boringness, solemnity, or sense of duty, and all these things, all these qualities, Wilde saw as hallmarks of the Victorian character. So when characters in the play use the word serious, they tend to mean trivial and vice versa. For example, Algernon thinks it shallow for people not to be serious about meals. In fact, we have a long discussion about him asking for cucumber sandwiches, which again is a trivial matter. The next theme that is taken up by us is the theme of dual identities. In fact, as Dr. Zakia said, that both the important characters of this play, that is Jack and Algy, they live with dual identities. And these dual identities, in fact, create crisis in their lives, and all these crises get sorted out later on. But these, the process of the crisis leads to a lot of laughter. The last is idleness of the leisure class and the aesthete. In fact, we find that Algy can be called a hedonist, a person who enjoys to eat, to gamble, to gossip. And he is, on the other hand, he is very serious about cucumber sandwiches. He is serious about trivial things, and he is trivial about serious things. In fact, through this character, through Algy's character, we find that Algy is a representative of Oscar Wilde himself. And therefore, through Algy, Oscar Wilde wants to state that art does not mirror reality. In fact, he subscribes to the 19th century philosophy of aestheticism, which we find through this play, which was espoused by Walter Pater. Now, we come to some of the political issues of importance of being earnest. Now, we have already discussed that these political issues were not the primary motive of Oscar Wilde when he wrote this play, but he could not even he could not bypass these political issues. In fact, we find that none of the characters, not a single character, deals with the reality of the society. Or in fact, no characters relate with the politics of Ireland or the politics of England. And for example, the play revolves around the following subjects. Lady Bracknell examines Jack's suitability as a partner for Gwendolen. She inquires about politics. Jack is a liberal unionist. Now, one subject which has been taken up or which has been kept in the background, is the subject of home rule for Ireland. This lady, we find that she is quite uneasy, and her uneasy feeling is related with the feeling of fear that is regarding the social unrest. In spite of the play being away from reality, in spite of the fact that the play had nothing to do with the politics of that time, why was the play a success? The play, which was staged in 1895, and it was an immediate success. Although it was written as a farce, the importance of being earnest is actually an attack on Victorian society. It is an attack on social and moral hypocrisy of the people of that time. It is an attack on the social class system of that time. It is an attack on the attitude of marriage of that time. It is an attack on marriage as a social tool at that time. It is also an attack on the triviality of aristocratic life. In spite of all these things, why the play was successful, and the reasons can be two. The first is that the characters are distanced from the audience. The characters are away from reality, and therefore the audience is able to laugh at the characters, not only laugh at the characters, but also laugh at their own society. And the second reason that we find is, of course, to do with Oscar Wilde's own style of writing, which we have discussed earlier, is called epigrammatic style. A few examples that we have chosen, which you can see on the slide. The first is, divorces are made in heaven. In fact, this epigram pokes fun at the popular phrase, a marriage made in heaven. Or the second example can be, the truth is rarely pure and never simple. Again, it pokes fun at the phrase, the pure and simple truth. And the third example that we have chosen is, in marriage, three is company, two is none. Again, Wilde has taken the popular saying, two is company, three is a crowd, and then adopted it to suit his own purpose. Now let us analyze some of the major characters of this play. Jack Worthing, who is the play's protagonist, he was discovered as an infant by the late Sir Thomas Cardew in a handbag in the cloakroom of a railway station in London. We find that Jack is the pillar of his community. He leads dual roles. He plays dual roles in his life. For example, in Hertfordshire, he is a responsible citizen. He is a guardian to Mr. Cardew's granddaughter, Cecily. He has other duties and responsibilities as a citizen. People depend on him. There are people like servants, tenants, farmers, local clergymen. They all depend on him. Whereas the other side of his life, which he leads in London, in the name of Earnest, where he escapes from reality. In fact, he leads the role of an irresponsible younger brother of his own life. And therefore, these two lives that he leads makes him represent conventional Victorian values. He wants others to think that he adheres to the notion of duty, responsibility, honor, respect, whereas he himself hypocritically flouts all these notions. In fact, through this character, we find that Oscar Wilde was actually satirizing, through Jack, the general tolerance of hypocrisy of his own time. Earnest enables Jack to escape the boundaries of his real life, and Jack wants to be seen as an upright, moral citizen of his country, and he doesn't care what lies what lies he has to tell his loved ones. So on one side he is leading a very forthright life, and on the other side he is flouting all the notions of Victorian life. The second important character is whom we call the secondary hero of this play is Algernon Moncrieff. He is in fact closer to the figure of Oscar Wilde himself. He is closer to the figure of the dandy character. He can be seen as a character who is charming, who is idle, who is a decorative bachelor. And he is in fact known for his brilliant, witty epigrams. And he is also known for his selfish, immoral side. He is given to making delightful, paradoxical, epigrammatic pronouncements. And like Jack, Algernon in fact has invented a fictional character, and that is his chronic invalid called Bunbury. Algernon, we see him as a proponent of aestheticism and a stand-in for Wilde himself. We find that this particular character is quite close to some of the other characters of Wilde's plays, for example, Lord Darlington in Lady Windermere's Fan, or Lord Illingworth in A Woman of No Importance, or Lord Henry Wotton in The Picture of Dorian Gray. Unlike these other characters, we find Algernon to be completely amoral, where Lord Illingworth and Lord Henry, they are downright evil, whereas Algernon has no moral convictions at all. He recognizes no other duty other than responsibility to live beautifully. The third character that we are going to look at is the character of Gwendolyn Fairfax. Gwendolyn Fairfax, amongst all the female characters of the play, she suggests the qualities of conventional Victorian womanhood. She has ideas, she also has ideals, she attends lectures and is bent on self-improvement, she is artificial, she is pretentious, she is in love with Jack, and actually she is fixated with the name Earnest. In fact, she can serve as a metaphor for the preoccupation of the Victorian middle and upper class with the appearance of virtue and honor. So this fixation for appearance and name is very close to her character. Like her mother, we find her to be very self-consciously intellectual. Like her mother, she is fashionable and sophisticated. She also seems to be strongly minded. And she speaks with unassailable authority on matters of taste and morality. The last character that we are going to look at is the character of Cecily Cardew. If Gwendolyn is a product of London high society, Cecily is its antithesis. This is important for us to note. She is a child of nature. In fact, she has been described in Act 2 by Algernon as ingenuous, as unspoiled, as a pink rose. So she has been compared with pink rose because of her ingenuity and unspoiled nature. But again, she is herself obsessed with Earnest, with the name Earnest, like Gwendolyn. She is also a fantasist. She lives in her own romantic world, and she has invented her romance with Earnest. Cecily, in fact, in spite of all these fantasisms, we find that she is probably the most realistically drawn character of the play. She's quite close to Wilde's notion of life. She is the only character in this play who does not speak in epigrams. Her charm lies in her idiosyncratic cast of mind, her imaginative capacity, her qualities that derive from Wilde's notion of life as a work of art. These elements of her personality makes her a perfect mate for Algernon. Now let us look at some of the film adaptations that have been made. There are three major adaptations. These were TV adaptations that have been made, which are known as made for television versions. One was in 1952, the second was in 2002, and the third is quite recent, that is last year, 2011. There is interesting to note that one Indian version also came out in Telugu, that was in 2008, and the name was Ashtachamma, which was released in 2008. And the film version which came out in 2011 is also a Broadway revival of Oscar Wilde's play of the same name. And this film was directed and starred by Brian Bedford. That brings us to the close of the discussion, but before closing this discussion, it is also important to take a look at some of the important themes that have been taken up by us. Zakia, would you please?
We deliberated great length at the thematic concerns, keeping in mind how these characters are located. But I guess as students of undergraduate level, there are certain pertinent questions, not just keeping your exam in mind, but also keeping the fact that how do you relate a text. One important way, as we had done in our presentation today, is that we try to locate the text through the context. So how does this particular play addresses the Victorian era? In other words, a question could be representation of Victorian era in the play, importance of being earnest, which is associated to another important parallel question on the whole question of institution of marriage and the hypocrisy of the gentry class, which you can weave along with your discussion on these three important characters, which just few minutes back my colleague had just mentioned to you. How do you locate Gwendolyn, how do you locate Fairfax, how do you locate Lady Bracknell, how do you look at Jack and Algy, not in terms of prospective brides and bridegrooms, but also as manifestations of the Victorian way of looking at men and women. Since it's a comedy of manners as a form, the question on mannerism also becomes important when we look at the way these characters behave. So one way of trying to interrogate the text could also be that we relate mores and manners of Victorian era vis-a-vis the characters and the plot of the play. I believe there could be some more questions, Madhurita, from you.
Yes, one important thing that we must note is that when we are reading Oscar Wilde's plays, not only this but other plays also, we have to look beyond, we have to go beyond the play, because the play is meant to be, superficially it looks like a play which is a comedy, but it is actually not comedy. It is being used as a tool to make fun of something. So we need to address that. So as students of English literature, you must note that what you see is actually not what you see. So you have to go beyond the text. So what we would as teachers advise you to do is that read the text, but also take into consideration the background of the age that the dramatist come from, and especially Oscar Wilde's plays cannot be seen as plays themselves. The second thing which again you must address when you are preparing for your examination is the issue of the philosophy which was used to write this play. As we had discussed in our presentation, that the play is based on a philosophy of aestheticism. So please read about what is aestheticism, what are the central principles of aestheticism, and why this particular play, which is used to address the philosophy, is linked with the characters of the play. So if you address these three issues, the first is the play itself, the second is the background of the play, the society of the play, the period of the play, and the third is the philosophy of the play. If we link these three issues together, then we would be able to appreciate critique and understand Oscar Wilde in a better way. And for this, we have a few suggestions. If we can have the slide, please.
Yeah.
Suggestions for further reading. There are some books which you must take a look at. They are also available on the net. For example, Harold Bloom's book called Oscar Wilde, or we have Joseph Pierce's book, The Unmasking of Oscar Wilde, which is published in 2001. And one important book which you can also look at is The Importance of Being Earnest, A Reader's Companion, which was published in 1995. So these books would help you understand the play in a better way. So leading Oscar Wilde or understanding Oscar Wilde as an Irish dramatist is not enough. We need to understand the society of this particular dramatist. We need to understand his sexual orientation. We also need to understand his own discomfort with the hypocritical notion of Victorian society. So with this, we end our presentation.
One, I mean, it's not again a pun by us, but then we looked at the manifestation of the word earnest, and as students of literature, of course, as budding scholars right now, your earnest endeavor should be to go beyond the trivialities of the text and decode the serious connotation. And that makes a better understanding not only of the play, but also of the playwright in question. And that makes our job as teachers and as students belonging to this fraternity a more proactive approach.
So what appears as superficial when we say importance of being earnest, two things have to be taken into consideration. The first is importance. What do we mean by importance? Whether important, what is important, what seems to be important is important at all, or what is not important is important, right? And the second thing is earnest, the meaning of the word earnest, which suggests two qualities, qualities of being sincere and qualities of being serious. So when we understand the play, we have to also look at the subtitle of the play, and the subtitle leads us to the plot and the details of the play. So with this, we come to the end of our presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.